Good evening, and welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. I'm Blair Seitz. I'll be your host tonight. Centering on Peace is a program of the Berks Peace Community. Berks Peace meets at the Friends, that is a Quaker meeting house, every first Monday of the month. Last Monday, for example, we had a program on the bipartisan issue of gerrymandering. Centering on Peace is sponsored in part by the Berks Peace Community and also by the Wells Fargo Foundation. This is a call-in program, so we welcome you to call in, make a comment, or ask us a question. The number will be on your screen. It is 610-378-0426. Tonight's program is Healthcare, What Next? Or we might say, What's Best? My guests tonight have some pretty good ideas about that, and they greatly surpass what is happening in the House and Senate right now. This is a hot issue because in the next couple of days, the Senate is going to put out their plan. I have three guests. Rosie Skomitz is a retired teacher of 33 years in the Daniel Boone School District. And with her husband, Ron Stauffer, she is coordinator of the Berks County Health Care for All PA. Stephan Maman is a medical student at Penn State Hershey College of Medicine. Welcome, Stephan.
Thank you.
And Dr. Bill Davidson. Dr. Davidson is a cardiologist. He's a graduate of the University of Virginia. He lives in Annville, PA, and he is active with the Physicians for National Health Program. So Rosie is with the state program, and Dr. Davidson will be speaking more probably about the national program. Our healthcare discussion is timely because of the Senate's potential coming out with their bill in the next couple of days to replace the Affordable Care Act, or what we have called Obamacare. Now let's make it clear that the panel members tonight are advocates for what they consider a far better healthcare approach than either Obamacare or the Health Care Act that has been passed by the House and is trying to get traction in the Senate. Our panel will explain and advocate for what has been referred to as a single-payer system, or universal health care, or sometimes Medicare for all. Be aware that if we use the term single-payer or Medicare for all, or universal care, we're talking about the same thing. Tonight, the panel will make comparisons of Obamacare, the current House proposal, and Medicare for all. Stephan, let's talk with you, start with you. Like, you're a med student. Mm-hmm. You're in your second year?
I just started my third year.
So I can't quite call you a doctor yet, but it's almost there. So what influenced you to feel strongly about Medicare for all?
Sure. So, my dad doesn't have health insurance, but he does have diabetes, hypertension, chronic diseases, which can give you a variety of problems, kidney problems, heart problems, and some of the things that really kill most Americans. I grew very frustrated trying to find a place for him to see a doctor. There were low-income clinics where I'm from in Las Vegas. We tried to get him in there, but he still couldn't make some of the payments that they still required. We even, once Obamacare came out, and he's actually a staunch Republican and was opposed to Obamacare, but I got him to finally look at the exchanges and try to figure out if he could, get on there and find a plan. But he still was having a hard time meeting the minimum, the required payment that he would make for the cheapest plan that really didn't cover very much. In this kind of free market, so to speak, solution. And he also just barely didn't qualify for the subsidies. And so he was kind of stuck in this limbo where he couldn't really afford to get insurance. If he did, he wasn't really going to get very much coverage, useful coverage. And I just grew very frustrated seeing the system. And I was looking at what other countries had done to ensure all their people, and realizing that there were far better systems and place in other places in the world, where in the United States we have a lot of wealth and we can implement these kinds of systems, but we're not. What I started realizing was that simply so that other healthcare corporations could profit more, essentially so a lot of people could make a lot of money, but not necessarily so that people could actually access healthcare. And so the more you look into this issue, the more you realize it's really unfair.
And for you, it's very personal. That's a very personal commentary about your father. Wow.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, and that's really what drives me. And I think most people who are involved in this discussion are driven by some kind of personal, problem that has come about because of the fact that the healthcare system is so corrupt and essentially bankrupts people or is inaccessible to people. And with my father especially, I mean, he could easily be put on medications that have been around for a long time that are very good at reducing blood sugar levels, for instance, and preventing disease. In the meantime, we can't do that because the healthcare system is so corrupt. He's not qualifying for things, and it's incredibly, incredibly frustrating. So I do have a strong desire to try to influence change.
Rosie, tell us about your work with Healthcare for All PA, and what got you started in this.
Well, I think Stephan has said it very well about seeing what's wrong with healthcare in the United States. And many years back, my husband and I decided that the healthcare system in the United States is broken and it needs to be fixed. And single-payer healthcare is the most logical approach to do it. It's the most economical, and it covers everybody. The problem with even the Affordable Care Act was that it did not cover everybody. There were still half of the people that were uninsured before Obamacare went into effect. Half of them were still uninsured once that program was in place. And that's not acceptable. We need to be covering everybody, and single-payer health care, and in particular the Pennsylvania health care bill, HB 1688, was something we supported because it covers everyone with affordable payments into the system and then comprehensive coverage with the system.
In a little while, we'll bring up a very simple graphic that will show this. But Dr. Davidson, we want to get off on a footing of knowing exactly what we are talking about, comparing what it used to be with Obamacare and the bill that has passed the House, and wherever you want to go with that. Would you like to do it?
Yeah, Blair, we're at a point here where I think it may be a little history lessons appropriate because, we've heard so much recently about, how awful Obamacare is, which, of course, is hyperbole. It has some good points to it. But then we see what the American Healthcare Act is that the recent representatives in the House produced, and that by almost any standards is horrific. So we're now faced with, you know, two plans that have been publicly considered bad. So we, as single-payer Medicare for All advocates, kind of feel we've got an opening now in which we can, you know, really show the American people what would really be worthwhile. I guess for the first slide, we can show that. And with the first slide, I'm basically acknowledging the national organization of which I'm a part, Physicians for National Health Program. And basically, this is an organization of about 20,000 physicians who have supplied a lot of the background studies and economic studies to show how favorable a system we could have if we simply went with a single payer or Medicare for All.
And I understand that you have 20,000 members?
That is correct, and growing all the time, I might add. The next slide, I think, starts us off with the history of really where we were prior to Obamacare, because, you know, you often hear saying people say, well, we had the best healthcare system in the world, and it was terrific, and why did we bother to change it? Well, this is the legitimate reason why we did change it, because prior to Obamacare, we had 50 million people. That's one out of every six American had no insurance. And when you do not have insurance, you have a problem in this country, as any country, I guess, because when you're uninsured, you simply don't do as well. And in fact, there's a correlation between being uninsured and dying before your time. Not only did we have 50 million uninsured, we also had outcomes that, you know, for the richest country in the world, our outcomes were mediocre, and in many cases fell behind most of the industrialized countries in the world. And of course, there were other aspects of it. We've had like a 500,000 medical bankruptcies. I mean, this is unheard of in the rest of the, you know, industrialized world, but we had a 500,000 in this country. And of course, we also have the most expensive healthcare system in the world by a factor of 2 to 1. The next slide, of course, shows, well, Obamacare came along and it did some good. It cut the number of uninsured by one half, so we're down around 25 million. It expanded Medicaid. That's where states allowed, and as you know, the Supreme Court made a decision in that regard, and so some states opted not to expand to Medicaid, which seemed pretty insensitive to the needs of poor folks. I might add that I work in a free clinic and have done so for about 7 years here in central Pennsylvania, and we're very happy to help people qualify for Medicaid, because even though it may not be the best system in the world, it is certainly for that patient a lot better than nothing at all, and a lot better than being uninsured. And of course, Obamacare did extend the age in which children can be covered under their parents' policies. It did produce some essential benefits, which were very worthwhile, because many of the insurance policies that were quote-unquote affordable before were simply not able to cover you if you really got sick. And then other things like patient-centered programs that were helpful. But unfortunately, Obamacare came up short. That still left 25 million uninsured. The drug and insurance companies were still in charge. Obama gave up the right to group negotiate with the pharmaceutical industries to try to bring down prices. Restricted networks became even more pervasive. I mean, I obviously I get a little mad, but I also get, you know, start to laugh when I hear that government-run healthcare would restrict your ability to see the doctor and the hospital of your choice, when in reality it's the private insurance industry that is doing that. And you know, we've seen cases where people, you know, in an emergency, you're having a heart attack. I mean, you can not very well pick the, you know, the hospital you're going to go to, and then you show up in a hospital, and this hospital happens to be out of network, well, you may get a very, very big bill. And it's even more complicated than that, because you could go to a hospital, you're in that network, but it so happens the doctors that were taking care of you aren't in your network. So you might get a big bill in that regard as well.
You told me one time, Dr. Davidson, about a big bill that you got in the mail by surprise.
I got a registered letter. I won't say the institution, but a very well-known institution in Pennsylvania. And the bill was for over $100,000 for a three-day hospitalization. And fortunately, my insurance covered it. But you can imagine if you were a person who may be a little less knowledgeable about how healthcare affairs work, and you might have taken that $100,000 bill and said, I'm going to lose my home. It was a pretty frightening experience, even for me, at my more or less more sophisticated level.
One thing I would add to that as well, I, you know, started working on the wards because it's my third year, and we have patients who come in, and there is a drug of choice, a drug that has been shown to be the best for whatever they're dealing with. And we will actually not be able to give them that drug because the health insurance company says, we will not pay for this drug. Mm-hmm. Under a single-payer system, it would be evidence-based. There would be, what is the best drug to, you know, to provide to this patient based on the research? And you wouldn't be denied that drug because your insurance company, you know, says, no, we can't do that because we have to pay our CEO billions of dollars. Mm-hmm. It's, you know...
The beauty of a single-payer system is that it takes the middleman insurance company out of the equation. And it is simply the provider, the doctors, etc., and the financing mechanism, which in our case would be a public finance system. So you're taking a lot of the cost of medical care out of the system, out of the equation, so that that money can actually go for health care.
When we analyze it, we see that for every $100 spent on health care, about 30 cents of that or $30 of that $100 actually goes to administer it. That's the present system we have. Very inefficient because of such high administrative costs. If we indeed had an administrative system like they have in Canada, where they have a single payer system, that the amount to administer would be more like $16. So the difference between $16 and $31 is quite a bit when you consider that that percentage, that 15%, is multiplied by $3.2 trillion, which is the cost of healthcare in America every year at this point in time, and of course, rising with each year.
Do we need to say yet, Dr. Davidson, about the bills that are in the House and Senate, or?
Yeah, I think the next slide, President Trump basically made the statement when he was campaigning that he was going to provide us with a better health care situation than Obamacare, and it would cover everybody and at a lower cost. But the reality of what came out of the House in the American Health Care Act was a totally different story. Essentially, what took place was it reduced the funding to Medicaid by $800 billion, which, you know, how... you know, far-reaching, significant effects on our on the people that really require health care the most, the poorest segments of our society, and a number of other aspects of it. There's a tax reduction to the richest 2% that is in excess of $300 billion. So it's like taking from the poor and giving to the rich. And, in the end of the day, the number of uninsured will go way back up to around 50 million folks who will be uninsured at the end of 10 years. So it really makes the comments by President Trump look very foolish and duplicit, because indeed there will be more uninsured if that bill is passed. And of course, right now we have a bill in the Senate that they're working on. And, you know, it's really a sad commentary on the times that most of this is being done behind closed doors. There have been no public hearings. When the bill was passed in the House, they did not even have the Congressional Budget Office review it before it was voted on. Really a sad commentary, I would say, on our legislators.
Maybe this would be a good time. Rosie, you gave me that graphic, which we gave to the studio, a very simple graphic of who would pay in Pennsylvania and how much we would pay. And then we can talk about business and their relationship with...
The Pennsylvania health care plan, which is for the state of Pennsylvania, a single-payer plan, has individuals contributing 3% of their income into this fund, and employers paying 10% of payroll into the fund. And it's been verified by an economic impact study that this will fund the medical payments, the medical bills of Pennsylvania citizens. It's a very simple plan. And when you look at what we're asking in this legislation compared to what people now are paying, 3% is a very small amount of a person's income to pay into the fund. If you're paying premiums for health insurance, you're paying a lot more than that. And businesses also, to pay 10% of their income, some of them are paying 20% or more. We're cutting costs tremendously with the Pennsylvania healthcare proposal. And I would say across the board, municipalities, school districts, businesses, everybody is spending less money, is saving a lot of money with the Pennsylvania health care plan. We show our local school district saving millions of dollars a year. Why would you turn your back on this?
Well, that's what I'm asking to myself as I'm
exactly.
here, sitting here listening to you. Scenario that we have now has been kept alive a lot by myths. Myths about choosing your own doctor, myths mm-hmm. about waiting times that they have in Canada, myths about, some other mm-hmm. myths. Like, what about this thing in Canada or in England?
Well, I have friends that have vacationed in Canada and have needed medical services in Canada, and they couldn't say enough positive. Now, that's anecdotal, I realize, but by and large, the people in Canada are very pleased with their healthcare system. In fact, they did a survey a few years back asking people who the greatest Canadian ever was. And coming out way ahead of Wayne Gretzky was Tommy Douglas, who was the governor or equivalent of that office in Saskatchewan, who initiated the single-payer trial effort there, and it was so successful that it spread across the whole nation.
Well, what is an anecdotal, Rosie, is the fact that the people in Canada live longer. You know, we've heard, you know, horror stories perpetuated by the insurance industry and other people of very conservative ideologues who have said, you know, you get terrible care there. But hey, you live longer. That doesn't sound like terrible care to me. They have a much better infant mortality. And basically, the health care outcomes of the Canadians are every bit as good as that in the United States. And this is also true of, you know, the major industrial countries, really, of the world, like Germany and France. We tend to think, and we've been told somewhat erroneously, that we have the best healthcare system in the world. And yes, we do have very good healthcare here. Unfortunately, it isn't always available for everyone, and that certainly drags us down. But Canadians, they enjoy a good healthcare system, and for all the goodness that they have, they're paying half as much. What's not to like about it?
I saw, in doing research for this, two things. I saw a chart of how much doctors are paid in Canada, and the salaries look quite good. I mean, it's not that doctors aren't paid well in Canada. The other thing is that I read that it costs $1,600 more to produce a car in Canada because of the expense of health care, more to produce a car in America than it does in Canada because of the very high cost of health care. So it sounds to me like it would be good for our international balance sheet, our industries.
Advocates for, you know, Medicare for all and single payer have been saying this for many years, that we need to get the business community better informed, because indeed we have a system here that really would help them out. Now, obviously, if that particular business does not provide health care for their employees, and we impose, what, an 8%, 9%, 10% payroll charge to them, then obviously they'd be paying more. But the other part of that is it would be a level playing ground, because you wouldn't be competing against another business that is not providing health care when you do. So everyone would be in the system, all would have to pay. But there are a number of businesses that have really tried very hard to get on board. There's one in Pennsylvania, I can't remember the name of it, but that business just produced a movie called Fix It, and it was part of their commentary that they felt they could be more competitive overseas if there was a universal health care system. And even headaches are a problem. For instance, I've been told that businesses pretty much yearly go through the headache of having to renegotiate their contract with the insurance company, and invariably the premiums are higher. And it's really like it distracts them from what they do best, because they're so involved with updating their insurance coverage for their employees.
And that's using time that they could put to much better use just growing their business. And I think Fix It was done by a businessman in Easton, Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure either what the business is, but it's a very excellent movie. If you go to healthcareforallpa.org, you should be able to find references to that movie and places to access it. But I also want to say that, speaking of business, we don't think of Warren Buffett as generally a real champion of single-payer healthcare, but he has come out recently and promoted that concept, and saying regarding the tax cuts that Trump wants to put in place, that really the real villain in our economy that's sapping businesses is not taxes, it's healthcare costs. And he said, you know, medical costs, this is a quote, medical costs are the tapeworm of American economic competitiveness.
So I've often used the term parasite.
Okay, same thing, Bill.
Same thing.
How many, are there a lot of congresspeople, congresspersons, nationally and in Pennsylvania who are behind a single-payer system?
John Conyers was, I think, the leader of H.R. 676 in the Congress. Of course, Bernie Sanders, Senator Sanders, is a big supporter of single-payer health care. Do you know?
63 members of the House are on board, have co-signed H.R. 676, Senator or House Representative Conyers' bill. So, and that apparently is a higher percentage than they've ever had before of support for it. Now, obviously, the House is mainly Republican at this point in time, as in most of the Senate. But nevertheless, the Democrats, who at one time were holding off because they didn't want to undermine support for Obamacare, are now moving in the direction of single payer and a Medicare for all. I mean, we see that with the amount of dissatisfaction that's out there, that this is a real opening for advocates like us, the Medicare for All advocates, because the Obamacare, I think, a bit unfairly has been criticized, but the criticism has been pretty big time, and so a lot of people out there, you know, have deep-sixed Obamacare and associated with basically the Democratic Party. On the other hand, the legislation that just came out through the House Republicans, the American Health Care Act, I mean, it's horrendous. I mean, just about anybody looking at it from any perspective would say, this is really, really bad and very, very regressive. And that's, of course, now associated with the Republican Party. Whether they like it or not, they own it. So, you know, we, as single-payer Medicare advocates, we don't have that baggage. Yes, Bernie Sanders tried to get the Democratic nomination for president, but we know he's an independent. I think he's going back to that independent status. And, you know, he is, you know, independent enough that there really isn't a baggage with a particular political party. And so, you know, single payer, Medicare for all. Hey, we don't care who you are. This is good for everybody in this country.
Well, I'm a little surprised because given what's going through the House and about to go through the Senate, I thought you all would have your heads down, but you sound very enthusiastic and like you have high hopes of, I think, a lot more people seeing the light of day.
So I think you know, when people really look at this and look at the plan without the lenses of ideology, it's pretty obvious that it is a very fair, very good plan if you are not incredibly wealthy. But in the United States, although we don't have a very good healthcare system, we have a very good propaganda system. And it's very good at getting us to have this kind of horizontal division horizontal rivalry, right? So if you're either on the left or you're on the right, and you know your network tells you to believe this, Fox News tells you to believe this, MSNBC tells you to believe this, the spectrum of discussion is a very narrow spectrum. Single payer does not fall within that spectrum. Even you know, pseudo-liberal media channels don't actually support it. They're all pro-corporate. What we really should be looking at is the neighbor to my left and the neighbor to my right, who may have different leanings on this vertical spectrum. We actually have an incredible amount in common. We should be looking up at the people who own an inordinate amount of wealth and looking and saying, you know, is this fair? They're trying to create this rivalry between us, saying you should support this new healthcare bill that's coming out in Congress that is going to transfer wealth to the top, and they're going to try to convince people through their propaganda system that this should be supported. And then, you know, on the left, they're going to have their message from the mainstream kind of media, so to speak. But really, we should be uniting as people, as within the same, you know, if you don't make over, you know, several million dollars a year, you probably have the same interests as everyone else, like in your group. So I think that's why this is becoming so heated. Why are people yelling at each other over this issue? It's because it's by design. They're trying to make us hate each other over this so that we don't focus on, you know, looking up and saying who is actually, you know, giving us this poor system.
I think, too, one important word that we need to keep in mind is sustainability. And the problem, even with the Affordable Care Act, and certainly with what President Trump and Congress are promoting, those programs are not sustainable. You cannot keep up with the costs of such a program. And you certainly can't have universality. They will not cover everyone. And those are the two important factors that we have to keep in mind and promote to have everyone covered and everyone covered in an affordable manner.
I want to remind our audience that we have, this is a call-in program. You may call in and offer your comment or ask us a question. The number is 610-378-0426. And Rosie, cost, that's what you said.
Mm-hmm.
I have Medicare now, okay, because I'm so old.
Me too.
But when I had insurance, I was looking at the Eagles football game, and there was my insurance company making an advertisement, a 30-second advertisement, several of them, while I was watching football. I mean, advertising on Eagles football is very expensive. So advertising is a cost. What are other costs that Medicare would not have?
Well, I have here, for example, and this is from just a couple years ago, something from the New York Times giving the salaries of top corporate executives.
And I think Bill has a slide on this, too.
Okay.
Should we do that?
All right, sure.
Well,
I just have, for example, the president of Aetna at that time was making almost $7 million a year. Now, that is obscene because the poor people are paying for health coverage that they can barely afford, and that money is going to pay an executive $7 million. Something wrong there.
It's a moral question. I agree with you totally, Rosie. If you look at this slide, Steve Hemsley, the CEO of United Health, you know, he, according to this, he makes $14 million. Now, my eyes glaze over when I hear millions and millions of dollars. But a number I can relate to, not because I ever made this much money, but simply it's a number I can get my head around, is he makes $55,000 every work day. I'll repeat that. He makes $55,000 every work day. Now, $55,000 happens to be the median family income in Pennsylvania for a year, and he makes it in a day. And you know what? That probably underestimates what he's actually getting, because there's lots of ways that folks like this can hide income, much less, you know, put it in an overseas bank account. So the amount of money is decadent. And it shows you that we have a system that can allow that kind of greed to take place. It's just horrible.
When children are dying, not to get sentimental, but it's real.
Well, and with the other factor is the pharmaceutical industry, which, you know, a couple slides that I have here on that just shows that in America, we spend a lot more than every other country for healthcare, and this slide demonstrates that. In case you were feeling sorry for the drug companies at all, you'll notice that they make, in general, it's a very profitable field because they make a lot more than the average of the other Fortune 500 companies. And just in case you were thinking, well, they got to spend a lot of money on research and development, if you'll note here about their cost structure, that they spend less than 15% of their monies on research and development. Again, most is spent on marketing and administration. And by the way, they don't pay all that much in taxes. So we really have, as Rosie pointed out, we have these middlemen that are basically fleecing us, but they're so powerful, and they can buy our legislators, and hundreds of millions of dollars is nothing to these folks when it comes to buying our legislators.
Very good. We have a home viewer. Let's hear from you.
Yes, hi, my name is Bob, and I wanted to ask the panel what they think the average citizen can do in order to promote a Medicare for All or single-payer plan like the federal proposal or the state proposal. I understand that a majority of Americans now support a single-payer Medicare for All model. And I actually just recently read that there are now 112 co-sponsors for 676. So I'd be interested in what all three panelists think the average person can do to try to make this drive successful.
Thank you very much. We definitely want to go there.
Yes, thank you for your call, Bob. I would say for the Pennsylvania plan, call your Pennsylvania state representatives and state senators and tell them that you support the Pennsylvania Health Care Act, which is a single-payer health care system. In the House, it's House Bill 1688. And I would say the same thing for 676 in Congress. Call those representatives. Be citizen lobbyists in favor of this legislation. Anybody else?
Any other comments?
Well, it's we know that our legislators are bought. I mean, it's very simple. I think the number that I remembered was $500,000 per congressman, and there's like 1,400 lobbyists from the pharmaceutical industry alone. So changing it at the top is pretty tough, and especially right now when we have a ideologically driven Republican Party in the Congress and at the executive level and really at the Supreme Court level. So it's tough to do it at the top, but there's some very positive things going on at the state level. And if we can publicize that and let that be known amongst people, for instance, California recently passed in the House a single-payer system legislation. And so that was a real positive finding. And, of course, New York has a program going on. And, of course, here in Pennsylvania, for a number of years, we've also been working at it. And I do think the breakthrough will be coming at the state level, at least in the immediate future.
I know Governor Wolf has said a lot about how the new program in Congress, in the U.S. Congress, would cutting out Medicaid would be devastating for Pennsylvania. So that might be a push. It's something else that came out of my research yesterday. Medicare, and then we're talking here about Medicare for All, in terms of the simplicity that we have been talking about. The rollout of Medicare in 1966 was amazingly smooth. Almost overnight, without computers, 6,600 hospitals were covered, 250,000 physicians, and within a year, 90% of Americans were enrolled. Any comments on that?
Well, it was a different day and a different age. And, I think part of the problem we're having in America today is the fact that, Stephan has commented, we're at each other's throat. We're not united. And I think healthcare may be the last opportunity we have to unite this country around a common cause, because, hey, we're all going to need it. You know, we all have these bodies that wear out. There's nothing unique about one person or another in that regard. And so I think we've got to come at the whole notion of the incredible inequality that is now present in this country and start that process of reversing that. And a single-payer healthcare system would go a long way to helping with the inequality problem as well, because suddenly, you know, your healthcare costs are taken care of. You no longer are at risk to go bankrupt. So I guess what I'm answering your question by saying there are some deep-seated problems that we also have to go after at the same time if we're going to make some headway.
Stephan?
I think one thing that's important to realize is that these people that are making a lot of money off of this system are buying politicians, are continuously reinforcing this system. And they are not considering what are the long-term implications of this. How is this country going to look if we continue to shift money all the way to the top and keep pushing that and pushing that? I think everyone listening to the show, we all have an interest to not allow that to happen. And you know, these corporations, they're not going to consider that for us. And we're going to have to push for legislation and other changes like single payer to not allow them to tear this society apart for profit.
Rosie?
Just say ditto to that, for sure. Mm. It's just an immoral system. It's not economical, it's not efficient.
One thing I think about sometimes is, do we hear people complaining about Medicare? I don't think people complain about Medicare. I mean, at the beginning of the year, we get this booklet, and it's very simple. It's very easily read, and you know exactly what's covered and what's not covered. Whereas if you take dealing with insurance companies, first of all, you have to go through the forest of knowing what insurance company you want to deal with, and secondly, knowing what that insurance company does and does not cover. I have on my desk to call my Advantage plan because I was denied something that was in the evaluation, which I think would be covered under Medicare.
I think this slide is an insight into why we need to change our general healthcare system. Medicare was a godsend. It took a lot of people out of poverty. It really did. And they have numbers to demonstrate and to prove that. Now, of course, in the meantime, over the last decade or so, the private insurance industry has insinuated themselves into the Medicare program. So we now have Medicare Advantage programs. Now, for a person who qualifies for it by being over 65, like myself, I may pick a Medicare Advantage program because there may be some minor advantages in it for me. But that type of program should have never been allowed to take place in the first place. And I think this slide demonstrates it very aptly because, in point of fact, it's costing the American taxpayers about 15% more to take care of a Medicare Advantage patient than a traditional Medicare patient. Now, you know, of course, the rhetoric when that was introduced, the Medicare Advantage program, was that, oh, well, private industry, private insurance companies can run things a lot better. Well, that turns out to be totally incorrect. They actually don't run things as well, and it's much, much more costly for the American taxpayer. So, again, this is a good demonstration of why we need to get rid of the middleman and get a system where we have more direct payment to providers and a much more efficient system that doesn't have the terrible administrative costs that our present system has.
And if I may add to, to the, you know, Medicare, a lot of people use it, a lot of people like it. You know, if it went away, a lot of people would suffer. And, you know, it's interesting because it is a socialized program. This is people paying into it and then, you know, getting back from it through the government. And but the word socialism or, you know, anything like that is very scary for a lot of people because the propaganda system has worked its magic and has convinced people that they should not support things that are in their own interest. So I'd like to point that out as well.
The term is always difficult because whenever I'm asked the question, well, I don't want socialized medicine, I usually respond by saying, well, what about Medicare? Because most people like Medicare. Most people, you know, oh, well, that's not socialized medicine. And I say, fine, well, what we're promoting is also not socialized medicine. And in fact, as a physician for many years, I worked under the Medicare system, and I had no one telling me how I'm supposed to take care of the patients. We feel that the best system, it would be a system like a Canadian system or Medicare here, where you have it publicly financed, but privately delivered by private physicians like myself. Now, I did work for a few years in the VA system. Now, that is truly socialized medicine.
Any other comment in the last minute that we have together? I want to thank you all very much. I think you gave us a lot of information.
Thank you, Blair, for your excellent questions, too.
Well, you're quite welcome. You're quite welcome, Rosie. I'll take so thanks, Rosie Skomitz, and Stephan Maman, and Dr. Bill Davidson. And we hope that we thank all of our audience for watching Centering on Peace again. And first, second Tuesday of next month, we will have a different subject, I hope. And it will certainly be as interesting. Thank you.